Welcome to the stage, Sheryl Lee and Dana Ashbrook.
Joanna Ray, the casting director, I'm sure you've heard her name before bandied about because she's pretty much responsible for bringing everybody to today's attention, was casting a bunch of shows at that time, and she cast a show called Amazing Stories for Spielberg's. It was like a show that he was doing, and I just heard a bunch of times and never got it. And my picture happened to be in the stack of pictures that David went through, and he just picked my picture, and I came in for a meeting. And I remember Eric Daray, who's played Leo, was Joanna's son. And he was running the session, and the casting session. So we talked, because I knew him. And so we talked, and we were laughing about the script. I'd read, Northwest Passage is what it was called at the time. And I'd read it, and we were laughing about the lady with the patch. And we're like, oh my God, the lady with the patch, but the drape runners. It's so funny. And we were laughing about it. And then I went into the meeting, and it was just David and Mark and me. And we just sat around and we talked about all sorts of stuff, like mostly nothing to do with Twin Peaks, just about like, I was in a theater company, we were talking about that for a while, and they talked about stuff. And then David said, well, Bobby doesn't smile a lot, so. And I was like, oh, no, I won't ever smile. And he also told me that he said I should work out. And I was skinny, super skinny, and I never did. But, and then I never auditioned. I had a work session with another young actress, I don't remember who it was, and we did the scene from the pilot with me and Shelley in the car of a happy hour in Francine. And I remember asking David if I should pretend to be driving. I was like, should I actually fake it? And he was like, yeah, fake it. So I was like, faking it. And we did the scene, and then I ended up going in for the network test. And when they brought everyone in, it was only one person for the part, which is usually, it's usually like four or five, and you have these other guys there, and it's like, oh, really uptight. But this was just one person for every part that was happened to be in this particular session. It was, Ray Wise was there, and Rich Beamer, and Lark Flynn Boyle, and, God, I don't know, a couple other people. And we were all there for our own parts. None of them were overlapping, so it was like we were all friends, and it was great. And that was it. And then the next thing I knew, I got it. And David wasn't even there for the network test, which is unheard of. It's usually, everyone has to see the test, but David already had signed off on everybody, so. Mark gave me the thumbs up after my reading for the network. It was like, and I was like, okay. That was it.
I was living in Seattle at the time, doing theater and studying theater, and I had an agent that was just sort of for commercial auditions or any kind of money-making gig that an actor can get when, they're doing theater. And she called me one day and said, you know this director, David Lynch, and I knew who he was, and she said, he's in town casting for a pilot for TV. Nobody knows anything about it, but he saw your photograph and he thinks that you're this dead girl. Can you come in and meet? And I didn't know anything about that world of television and film or casting like this or anything. And I was so nervous, I literally sat on my hands like this because my hands were shaking so bad, which they still do in auditions, by the way, when I'm holding the paper. So I sat on my hands and he just asked me questions like, how I would feel about being painted blue, gray, and wrapped in plastic, and dipped in freezing cold water. I was like, I'm fine, I'm from Colorado, I grew up swimming in mountain streams, like it's no problem. And he said something at the end, like, okay, well, let's do this. It was something that seemed very positive, but I thought, did I just get a job? I don't even understand. And I walked.
It's still like that.
It's still like that, exactly. It's so true. It's still like that. And then as I walked out, the casting director said something like, don't say anything. I'm like, about what? I'm so confused. But apparently I had been this character. And then I was hired for, 4 days as a corpse and did my dead work. And then, and a couple flashbacks, and then months and months later, David called and said, the show got, you know, we're doing the rest of the show, would you move to LA? And I was like, but I'm dead. But don't worry, we'll figure it out. And he did, thank God.
Did you know it was going to be some special, different, or?
No way. I mean, I only knew David from Elephant Man. It was the only movie I knew. I didn't know Blue Velvet, I didn't know Dune. And Eraserhead, I think, had been on cable, but I just didn't, you know, I was young and stupid, and I didn't get it. But now I do. I had no idea. I mean, nothing. Until we had the screening of the pilot at the DGA in Hollywood, and it was the first time I'd ever been to a screening of anything I'd ever done that was well-received. And like, people were coming up afterwards and being like, wow, that was really cool, or whatever, and I'd never seen it before, someone doing that. So it was like, wow. I didn't think it was going to be anything even after that, but it was like, people liked it at least, you know? It was like something that I did that people liked for the first time, and it was nice, so. But no idea. I had nothing, no clue.
Well, the first time I met him was at that audition in Seattle, and I had seen his work, and so I knew that he was very capable artistically of exploring the dark side, or the deep subconscious. So I just remember thinking, he just feels like family. He's so warm and funny and welcoming and immediately put me at ease and was kind and still to this day, all these years later, it was one of the most welcoming rooms that I've ever walked into as an actress. He just had a way, just so in his heart, and working with him, you know, it's like nothing else, because you get to constantly go to places that you didn't know you had within you, and he creates this world for you as a person and also as an artist where you really can soar. You can try things, you can go as far to the edge, you can jump off the edge, you can fall down the edge, you can land splattered on the ground, and you're gonna be okay. And it's just stretching and growing and being surprised and being in the moment and the spontaneity, and he carries that with him as a person. And I love his sense of humor. I really, on those long days, I greatly appreciated his humor.
Yeah, he's like a funny guy and laughs at your stuff. You know, he listens and laughs, you know, he interacts. He's not just like into his own thing at all. And one of my most vivid memories of working with him was like when we were just sitting around waiting for him to set up lights or whatever, and you know, you have 45 minutes where we're just sitting around. Some people go to the trailers or whatever, but it would be fun to just hang out on the set while they're setting stuff and over on the side or whatever and let them work. And he would take a can and he'd put a can out about 20 feet or wherever, and then he'd say, pick up 6 rocks. And so you have a bunch of people like looking around for rocks and picking up rocks. And then, you know, he had a contest of who's gonna hit the can. I mean, it was like literally that. I don't know if that's where the rock throwing contest came from. I don't know which came first, but we were definitely doing that on the set a lot. Like just hanging out, it was fun. Really fun. First time I met him was in that audition, and you know, it was him and Mark, and you know, I thought it was just like meeting an old friend, really, honestly. He was just such a warm guy, and didn't like judge or any weird things. He didn't feel insecure or whatever. He was just, you know, lucky to ever get in that room, honestly.
Well, he's such an artist. He's very specific. Like, I remember so clearly him coming over, and I kind of went into another zone, which was the way I had to do it, because I knew I was taped and I couldn't move and it was cold, and it was so I knew just I had to kind of go into this almost like a meditative state. And I remember him coming and like placing those sand grains exactly how he wanted them and making the folds of the plastic, and he was very specific about the color of the makeup, that it had to be a certain, you know, he has that artistic eye, so that is with him all the time.
When they pull that down off of her face, her eyes don't flutter. I mean, it's hard. If you've ever tried to do it on film, you get, like, it's all good until they say roll it, and then all of a sudden your eyes start going back and forth and back and forth. You try not to flutter. It's not easy. It's not even, she's just, like, dead. Amazing. Amazing. I was stoked for that.
It is great.
Yeah, it's hard. It's not easy. Dude, my high school, I wasn't really particularly into athletics in high school. I played, like, on a tennis team, but, like, at the basketball games, the football games, guys would go, whoop, 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 whoop. It was, like, a thing, and everyone would do it. It would be, like, this loud thing. It wasn't exactly what I did, but Dave wanted something, and he took me out. It was in this weird place we were shooting in Snohomish, and he took me out onto this balcony. It was actually a roof, like a rooftop where we were, because we were like on the second floor. And he took me out there, and he wanted me to practice some things with no one else around. So I was doing stuff. It was snow. It was snow everywhere. And we were practicing, I'm barking, I'm doing all sorts of different things. And then some guy that like was running the building came out and said, hey, you guys can't be on that roof. You're gonna crack the tar that keeps it from getting rain in it or whatever. And so David was like, oh, I'm sorry. And so we came in, and it eventually came what it was. He wanted me to hold that last yell thing. And then, and I remember right after the scene, Lara Fumboy was outside, and she was outside, and I came out of the jail set or whatever, and she was like, what the heck was that? What was that? She like couldn't get it. She was just like, what the hell? And yeah, that's what it came out as. My mom was very happy because my teeth looked very straight, and I don't have any cavities, so I have good teeth. Terrible eyesight, but good teeth.
I just kind of remember not really having a lot of intellectual information, just really staying in the moment and being able to, having to kind of just be, let everything reveal itself in the moment as it does in life.
I read the diary, actually. I mean, they said Bobby killed the guy in the pilot. I think you might have said it, or Laura. I think Laura Flynn Boyle, I think Donna said it to James. She's like, Bobby killed the guy, whatever. But I never really, I never knew who I killed or how or anything. Then the diary, I learned a little bit more about myself. But, most of the time we were just kind of trusting that the writers knew what was up, and the scripts were dynamite. They were just great scripts, so we just did. We just followed that sort of map, and it wasn't. We weren't sitting there going, God, did Bobby, does he like blue better or red better? It wasn't like that with me. At least, I was just staying with the actual story that I knew. But I was really surprised when they started, because for a second there, they started to maybe have Bobby and Audrey Horne have a thing, and then they brought in the character of Justice Wheeler, and that kind of went the other way, and it was just such a bizarre thing. I was surprised that they actually were kind of straightening me out a little bit. I was surprised, but it was fun. It was fun to try that stuff, too. But he's always a kind of an asshole. I like that part of it. I don't want to get too soft.
Well, I remember at first discovering that I was not anonymous. And I remember that was a very strange feeling. I had no reference. My parents aren't in acting or anything. And so I didn't grow up around it. And because Twin Peaks was my first television film experience, I had no reference in my life to what happens, or how do you navigate through this, or how do you adjust to this. And I remember the first few times of realizing that that was happening, and how sort of strange and out of sorts. I didn't know how to deal with it. And then I remember, and you guys have probably heard me say this in some interview somewhere, but people see me and they think they're seeing a ghost. So I would get, this all the time. It wasn't necessarily, it was, this constant sort of, I was forgetting that they're seeing me as someone who's already died. So then there was that part. And then there was just the difference in life in terms of, all of these other things that go with a television show, like press and them sort of having your schedule and like everything, all of that stuff that I didn't, it was almost like jumping on a roller coaster that I didn't know where it was gonna go. I just kind of had to fasten my seatbelt and breathe through it. I wish now that I could go back to that time and slow it down and really like, you know, be able to be more present with it. Because also that time in your life, I mean, we were trying to figure it out. We were like 22 years old. That's a time in your life that kind of goes fast, at a faster pace than other decades anyway. And to kind of have that happening at the same time during that part of my youth, you know, now as a 47-year-old, I'm like, I wish I could just slow it down and remember more of the moments where I was so just trying to keep up or feeling shy about it or not knowing how to deal with it, you know, but you just learn by going through it.
Trial by fire.
Yeah.
They were gonna do it, they were gonna do it, then they weren't gonna do it, then they were gonna do it, so I thought it was not gonna happen, really. I thought it was kind of a dead thing. You knew more, you and Ray and Kyle, you know, they were going through it more than I was. I just kind of, as soon as it was on, I was in, so. I was very happy. I was like happy to be back there, happy to be. We shot it in the same exact, we stayed in the same hotel we stayed at when we shot the pilot. And the pilot, that hotel had like had a fire and burned down, not all of it, but it had a huge fire. And so they repaired it since the year that we were doing the show in LA. And then we came back into the movie and it was the same hotel, this three floor, little red line inn in Bellevue, Washington. And it was like so great to be back there. Just go back, you know, it was great for me. I had a great time there. But she had the big load. I just had to show up for a couple scenes. She's the one that had to be, you know, brutalized and screaming, crying, and all that stuff. Not easy, you know, it's not easy.
It was a real gift, just creatively, because, you know, to carry that energy of Laura and in the pilot, and to have that life force be a part of your life for such a short time, I felt like I never got, it was never fulfilled. It was cut too short. So when he came to me and started talking about the possibility of doing this film that was gonna happen before she died, in a way it was such a relief, because it was a feeling of, oh, finally she gets to have a voice. Finally she gets to express what she needed to express. Finally, she gets to tell the story that she needed to tell. And David and I, we would just have these, he works in such a wonderful way, because you're just talking with him. Like, we would just have these creative conversations about Laura and posing questions and letting introspections happen and letting dreams happen and just kind of letting her start to regain her life force. And I feel like, you know, even filming, that's what he would do. I had this thing of, can we walk and talk, David? And he would just take me and take my hand and say, okay, you're just coming from Donna's house. It's, you know, and he would talk to me as Laura.
The scene in the movie that we had together, like we had a couple, but the main one was the one in the woods where we
came. I love that scene.
And that scene, I mean, it was like a serious, like a 10, 15 minute scene, a little long scene. And it was very choreographed. I mean, we were in the woods, it was freezing cold. It was like 3 a.m. And we walk off the start of that scene way deep into the woods and wait for Lindsey action. Then we'd walk down. You couldn't see us for like, you know, a couple minutes before we got to the set. And that was another time when David, like, at 3 a.m, whipped on the rubber gloves and wanted to, like, make the brains. And I lift up the guy's head and you see his brains. And that was all David. He put the brains on, he got in there, he was in there, he was into it. Into it. And I thought it was awesome. Right? And it was one of my favorite scenes ever to do because it was just so fun. I mean, it was just so, we were fucked up on drugs and alcohol and we were smoking weed.
Not really.
Not really, no. I mean, the scene, we got a bag of coke, we got weed, we're smoking, I mean, we were doing everything. It's ridiculous. And it was so fun. It was just such a fun scene for me to do, and she was great. She was so annoying with her. Bobby, and she's like, oh, we're killing the guy! Kill the guy! She's like, Bobby! It's like, oh. And David, you know, just like,
was so good at like making that happen, because it was annoying. It was powerful and it was real. It was great. I had so much fun doing that scene. It was one of those scenes where I said the F word a lot. I said it a lot. It was in the improv, and I'm like, "Barry, I'm like a fucking Barry." Yeah, all that was just improv out. You know, it was just kind of in the moment stuff. You know, and we, yeah, a little bit. It was structured, but there was definitely like moments where we were feeling whatever we were feeling, for sure. Absolutely.
Yeah, and for me, I don't tend to watch my work very much anyway, and because that was my first sort of major film, and seeing, I have a fairly normal separation of like, okay, that's Laura, and this is Sheryl over here, and that's Laura up on the screen, but it's still not necessarily the most comfortable film to watch yourself in. I haven't seen it in 25 years. I just saw the deleted scenes. I'm a fan of David's, so I like to see his work. I like to see how the story from the script, because he's so layered, he works so multidimensionally. So you're reading a script, but what you see, actually even before what you see, you read the script, you see your scene for the day, then you go to work, and he adds like 17 more layers. And then you see it up on the screen, and there's like 17 more layers. And I love that. So as a fan, I was curious to see it also, just to see what he had done with this story, what happened. And then, as myself, it wasn't the most comfortable moment. But
it was great for us, too, to finally, you know, get to see what Sheryl could do. Because, you know, she didn't get, you know, it was like, as Laura, she didn't get anything. And then, you know, as Maddie, it wasn't like as, you know, going off the chain as you did in the movie, you know what I mean? So we got to see her really get to do her stuff, which was nice.
But also to see everybody else. Like, that's one thing as an actor. When you work on a film, you don't see a lot of the scenes that are shot. You know, if you're not there that day, or if they're shooting something while you're in hair and makeup, you're not seeing what all the other actors are doing. And so when you finally see the finished product, there is also this wonderful feeling of seeing what everybody else had been shooting as well, you know, and being delightfully surprised and moved and taken, and, you know, just feeling so blessed to work.
Well, and it's such a different medium. I mean, that was a film, whereas TV, it's like, it's a different medium. Do you know what I mean? So it is going to be different.
Yeah.
It is going to be a different part of the story.
Yeah. I just remember feeling, you know, that I knew that Laura was going to go through all of this stuff. And I just kept kind of saying to David, I want to find, it's not that you can find a reason why somebody goes through this stuff, but that somewhere I wanted to still feel a sense of hope, you know, to not just have it end with, that was the end, that was her life, that somewhere, somehow, some way, her hope or her spirit could live on.
And also just the relief that she will have by being in death,
yeah,
you know, from the
exactly
torment and the torture of her life. It's like, come on, man, I get it. And I really hadn't really thought about that until you mentioned it, that it is sort of uplifting, and that's like, I want to see that again, you know what I mean? It's like making me think, wow, that's just a beautiful thing. Like, it's really saying something that I don't think I really have. It hasn't gotten here, you know what I mean? You know, there's so many people that are involved, and just the Hollywood, you know, thing comes into it, and all that stuff, and it was just like, but the first seven and the pilot were just like this pure thing where there was like, nobody knew, you know? We were out there in the valley shooting, no one knew we were there, no one cared, no one knew. It was great.
I don't know what your question was. Did I answer it at all?
Probably Leland, I guess, because he got to do some shit, you know what I mean? He got to really get in there. And Ray's my hero anyway, honestly. I love that guy, and I want to be Ray, so
I'd say Leland. And when we were doing, we worked together on a show up in Vancouver, and we were talking about the audition process that he went through for it, and he was talking about how he read for both Ben Horn and for Leland, and we were rapping about it, and someone that we were talking with about it said, you know, that would have been so different to have you with Ben Horn. It would have been such a different kind of vibe, and he was like, yeah, I don't know if I could have done it, and he sat there and he was like, yeah, I probably could. Because Ray can do it. Ray can do anything, man. He's the coolest. So, anyway, I guess Leland.
I'm gonna go with Diane.
I mean, I look at those actresses and I'm just in awe of what they did. I mean, I love Audrey so much. I love what Sherilyn did with it. I love what Majin did. Like, I can't imagine doing anything else. Because I'm just in awe of what they did.
That's fine.
So I'll stick with Diane.
It was like watching.
Oh my god. It was so surreal.
Is this on the screen?
Yes.
Yeah.
I took my little brother, who's 10 years younger than I am and who's a filmmaker, and I'm so glad that I took him because I don't think that I realized there just was no way to kind of think ahead of time of how that would feel. Because first off, like I said, I don't watch my work that much anyway. And so to watch my work and to watch it in a theater and to not know, I had no idea. I was trying to remember, what did we shoot, to not know. Then all these other scenes start coming up of, you know, the Bobby scene and, you know, Peggy Lipton scenes, and I'm like, oh, you, okay, good, this is all their scenes, you know, and that was wonderful, and I would kind of get lost, and then there would be a Laura scene, and it was this very strange feeling of having no sense of time, you know, that time, kind of being in between time, because some of the scenes I didn't remember filming. Enough time has gone by that I didn't even remember filming them. And then other ones I remembered as if it was yesterday and didn't remember that they hadn't actually been in the film in the first place. You know, so, and usually when you see your work, if you have to see your work as an actor, you're seeing it within a year of doing it, not 25 years later. You know, that was wild. But I was so impressed with the way that David put it together, because when Fire Walk With Me came out, there was this, it was obviously in discussion, there's this amount of film and the film is only this long, so where is this other part of the story and will it ever be able to get told? So there was a natural curiosity creatively of what is that part of the story and what would that do to the story if it was allowed to be told. But it was really great to see, you know, all of those, like, Peggy scenes and
I want to see the Peggy Everett scenes, the Peggy Lipton Everett McGill scenes that I heard are really sweet and lovely.
And Grace and Ray, and just to see all them again like that.
How did you find out about season 3, and is there anything you can tell?
I was at home on a Monday, and I got text from my other half, who's a daughter, my fiance. Her cousin was the first person to text me at like 8 in the morning. He was like, oh my god, you see this? And I saw it, and I couldn't believe it. I was like, what? And I immediately texted Cheryl, I immediately texted Kimmy, and I immediately texted Machen. And all three of them were like, huh? And I was like, okay, well at least they don't know, because I know they would know if they knew it, you know? And then a couple hours later, I got a text from Cheryl and Finn. And she was like, I talked to David, we're going back to Twin Peaks, we're gonna have some fun. And I was like, oh, okay, I didn't know what that meant. And then Cheryl told me when I got here that David said that we're both leaving. So she just... We don't know what our involvement will be. We just know what it is.
So I was waiting for the car to take me to the airport. First off, I'll go backwards a little bit, and I'll say this really fast. he texted me, and because he was on the East Coast and I'm on the West Coast, so he got the news first about the show. And I thought it was a total joke, or like some weird publicity, like April Fool's thing. And I was like, no way, no way, no, I know that can't be true. Then I found out, yes, in fact, it was true. And then, you know, had sent David an email, is this true, is this true, yes, it's true. And then we were all kind of texting and calling, have you heard from him, have you heard from him? Have you got a call, have you got a call? Like, we're all pretty close. And everybody's just like, you know. So then David had called me and I had missed his call and had called him back and was waiting for him to call me back. And so the car to bring me to the airport, to bring me till here, was pulling into my driveway and the phone rings and it's David and I'm like, I just have a couple minutes because the car is here to take me to the Twin Peaks Festival. And he said, well, you tell them you are and Dana is. And
did you know it would be him, Autumn?
Yeah. I found out, like just the day before we shot the scene with Maddie, but David took Ray and Leland and I, and because we had to shoot the scene with Maddie with Maddie dying with a smoke screen for the crew, so we had to shoot it with like three different actors. So David took us, myself and the three male actors, into his office, which had no furniture. It was like brown carpet and brown walls, and there's like a little clock with a waterfall. And we're sitting on the floor, and he told Ray, Leland, you killed her, and Cheryl, you're gonna die again. And we're gonna shoot it this way, you know, so that nobody knows. And we had to shoot it, obviously, with Bob as well.
So she had to go through it all those times, with all those different actors. She'd go through that thing. I mean, come on.
But that was the day, which I think was just within a week or something. I don't remember the exact time, but it was very, very close to shooting that scene. So it was right at the end. And I never knew. People were convinced that we knew. I never knew.
Oh, I never knew. I never even got those pages. Like, we would, like, if you weren't in the scene for something like that, you didn't even get it. You got some sort of half-baked something else, you know? But he kept all that stuff secret. I had no, until I watched it. But I wasn't asking either. I wanted to be surprised, just like everybody else.
Yeah, you know, I mean, the thing is, Ray was a father already at that time with a daughter, and so that part of it was, as a human, he was always, you know, that was in his life, in his consciousness. But then creatively, I mean, he's just so brilliant. I mean, he's one of those actors too. He can do it, and he can go from hysterical humor to terrifying, absolutely terrifying in a 10-second span, and you don't even know how he did that, you know. So I think he was disappointed in the human aspect of it, but the creative aspect of it also opened all these places up.
God, his hair went white, and he's driving with in the car with perfect. I think you and he has the golf club. I mean, just like awesome stuff, man.
The Lock Lady, always been scared about Bob, and I think I always will. And I would just like to know from you, from the first point of view, how it was working with Frank Silva. If he ever scared you, or if he was fun to work with, because he really still gives me creeps.
God bless him. God bless him. Sweetest, sweetest soul. You know, never, ever, ever scared me as a person. I mean, just I was so blessed to be able to work with the actors that I did in such scary scenes that were such kind, supportive men and humans and gentlemen. In the scenes, yes, I would feel fear, as I should, you know, because walking into that, I have to open up to be able to go to those places and surrender to that, whatever happens. And he was phenomenal. And
you know, he was like a crew member, right? Does everyone know that? He was the on-set dresser. He was like responsible for making sure all your shit gets back in place after each take. Yeah, it was in the reflection of a picture, I think, behind her bed, right? He's like hiding, they're like shooting, so he hides down there, and then David saw that, right?
Yeah, the camera like panned back and forth and caught him.
Right.
Yeah,
and that's how
lovely.
Oh, amazing. That scary long hair that's so scary was like, when you really knew him, it was beautiful. It was like, oh, that hair's amazing, you know? And it's so scary when he has it out.
And just, he had the ability to tap into that, like you said. He knew how to get there creatively, and it was awe-inspiring to watch and to be a part of.
And I love the way David was, too, man. He was like lightning in a bottle. If something like that happens, he could go with it, man. I remember in the pilot, there was a little tiny squeak that was like going from a fan up on top of the library scene when I'm getting interrogated by Andy and Truman. And it was a squeak that kept coming in, and he's like, ah, we gotta get rid of the squeak. And so the sound, the boom guy was like, hey, look. And he like moved his little sneaker across the shiny floor, and it made a squeak. And so he could like duplicate the squeak. And so David's like, shit, get that. So they just like recorded this guy squeaking his foot so they'd have a wild track of it. Crazy stuff like that, you know, it's like, sometimes you can have that on a set and it just turns into a disaster, but with him, it was like, it got captured and I don't know, it's beautiful. And he's lucky too, that's luck, you know. But you make your own luck, right?
Claire? Do you promise after the next series come out that you're going to come back and revisit us so we can ask you some questions about the following season?
I would love to. We didn't have the best time. We've only been here for 2 days, but we've explored extensively. And it's, you know, you guys are lucky. It's a beautiful, beautiful city to live in. I mean, I know there's every city has its stuff. I live in New York, I know. But, I mean, you know, it's beautiful. And thank you for welcoming us so much. Yeah. And it's like a pleasure to be here and experience another country and a lot of other countries, you know, people here that, you know, we don't even get to know that that's even happening in Russia or in Finland or wherever, Norway, wherever everybody's from. It's fun for us, you know? Norway! All my friends in Norway!
Have you any advice for a young director?
Definitely it's kind of what we've been touching on with David. I was fortunate to work with him at the beginning of my career, and his ability, as Dana was saying, to be present in a moment so that he has his blueprint for the day, for the scenes that need to be shot, but things change, lights don't work. You know, there's the scene where I'm in the morgue and the lights are blinking. That was because the lights didn't work and he was willing to go with it, and it works wonderfully. Or Bob, you know, discovering Bob, and all of these moments that happen where it's like you show up to work and there's something that's bigger than you that's needing to tell this story. And then advice, just stay true to yourself, follow yourself. There's so many things of, you know, do this, do that, don't do this, don't do that, you should do this, you should do that. Your artistic voice inside of you is unique to you. It's not like anybody else. So you have stories that you need to tell, that we need to hear, because they haven't been told yet.
Yeah.
I would just say that be true to yourself, like stick to your guns, but also be open to suggestions and let people suggest things. And if you don't want them, just don't take them. You know, you don't need to make anyone feel uncomfortable for bringing them up. You know, it's like with David, you could always bring stuff to him, and if he doesn't like it, he'll say, you know, fine, okay, we just move on. But other times he's open to it, you know, so it's like try to keep that sort of free-flowing communication, because you never know what you're going to get, you know what I mean? Let's just try to be open. That's my main thing. Just try to be open and keep that openness.
You know, I've worked on films with actors that I have great chemistry with, but they don't like to rehearse. But I love to rehearse. So how do you, as the director then, you know, you have to be able to speak different languages, and you have to be able to work with each actor within their comfort zone and yet be able to bring them all together It's a true art, it really is. And communication is a really good skill to have.
And we're all not from the same acting school, you know? I mean, we come from every walk of life. Some people come from Juilliard and from, you know, Carnegie Mellon, and they come trained and they come, you know, skilled. And, you know, there's people like me that come from San Diego and moved to Hollywood when they're 18. You know, there's no, I learned on my feet, learned on the job, you know? So everybody comes from different places. So our advice to you is be open to that and accept it all.
You know, I mean, I just feel like I had a bit of the same feeling with Mark that I had with David in terms of there's something very familiar about him. There was something very, I don't know if it was because I had grown up a lot in small towns and just in the writing and the way of helping me feel like, and helping everybody feel like they were a part of this whole process of telling this story. You know, it's really, there's so much to be said for that kind of welcoming and making people feel comfortable and making people feel like they are a family.
Part of a team.
Part of a team, part of this togetherness. You know, I mean, just great.
And he also kind. Kept things, you know, from, you know, he could sort of sometimes be the you know, I guess, I don't know Dana, David, and Mark, but I mean, I know that they work really well together and they're very different people artistically. I don't know how they're that different. I don't know really that much about whether they're different, you know, with their ideologies or whatever, but he is, Mark is like sort of came from Hill Street Blues, a very, you know, great television show, and had this great sense of how to make a narrative and in a television sort of world and keep that story going. So he brought that to David, you know, and Tony Kranz, the guy that put them together, was sort of genius, you know, because he took this guy that was awesome TV and this guy that was an amazing, you know, independent, like, powerful filmmaker and put them together. And this is what came out of it. And it started a whole thing, you know, it started people from film going into TV and making, like, little hour-long movies, you know. And Mark, you know, Mark had just as much of responsibility and a voice in the show. He might not have been the face of the show like David, but he definitely had a lot to do with it. You know what I mean? I mean, I think he's probably, he's probably like, doesn't get as much credit as David, but he's just as equal, honestly. For what he brings, you know what I mean? David brings a whole different thing, but they both bring things that are important.
I learn so much from you guys. I am touched by you guys. I am inspired by you guys. You guys are probably the reason why we get to go back to work next year.
Sure.
Your loyalty, your ideas, your creativity, your commitment, your dedication. Thank you so much.